speed lathe, engine lathe, gap bed lathe, then geared head lathe, bench lathe. When we were actually discussing about capstan and turret lathe, where we left in the last class. So we'll continue with that. The capstan and turret lathes are what are called as the special purpose machines. So where when we need a lot of protection, I think I already gave you an example, like if you have a rod where you need to turn it, face it, and then probably you may have to drill, and then you may have to cut the thread. So like this, there are various operations. So if it is an ordinary lathe, every time you need different tools, and then you need to change the tools after every operation. And then if this component need to be made in large number, so that becomes very tedious for the operator to do that. And also the time, production time will be very high, and we don't deserve that. So in order to make the production fast, when CNC machines were not there, so nowadays actually we have the CNC, that is computer numerical control machines. So where we have what is called as ATC, automatic tool changer. So by using which we can change the tools, and the tool changing time is of the order of like 2 seconds, 3 seconds or 5 seconds. So fast, quite fast. So by using that, nowadays we do several operations. But when these type of machines are not there, and also these CNC machines will be more expensive, and then they are more suitable for what is called as batch production. And if you want mass production, where you want to produce large number, so these kind of automated lathes like capstan and turret lathe, so they will be much helpful. With a lower cost, you can produce very high production rates. So now here, what is this capstan and turret lathe is? You can look at the figure here to the top and on to my right. So you see something different from what usually you see. Here there is a provision for mounting several tools. We are going to show you a video where you can understand that. So there is a provision here to mount several tools, and then whatever the tool you want, we can actually index it and put it into the position, and we can carry on the operations. So that is called as the capstan and turret lathe. And we can see actually what is the difference between this capstan and turret lathe. So here turret lathe means the tools will be mounted on the hexagonal turret, where this turret itself will be mounted on the saddle. So this is called as the saddle. So where the tailstock used to be there in the earlier normal machines. So we have a saddle, and on that there will be a turret. But in the capstan lathe, so here also there will be a hexagonal turret to mount several tools and index them. But the difference is that this turret is mounted on an auxiliary slide, so where it can move along the axis of the workpiece. So it can move along this one. So that is the difference. So what is the difference is, in a turret lathe and even in capstan lathe, you have a turret. So generally it will be hexagonal turret where you can mount 6 tools, or it can be even 4 tools or other thing, but generally it will be an hexagonal turret where there will be a provision to mount 6 tools. So here in turret lathe, the turret will be mounted on the saddle, but in a capstan lathe, so it will be mounted on the auxiliary slide. Yeah, somebody sent a message telling that the slides are blinking. I think that error is there quite for some time. So where because of network, it says the bandwidth is not sufficient. So I'm not anyway moving the slides very fast. So there is sufficient time to look at them. So we are not able to. We tried with all our technical people to do that. I don't know where the problem is. Okay. So please bear with that. So we'll continue. So here in the capstan lathe, the turret itself is mounted on an auxiliary slide. Okay, so where this auxiliary slide can be moved front and back so that we can feed them automatically. So that is the purpose. So now probably when you look at this video, you will understand that. So hope this video will be playing properly. Several tools which are mounted on this turret, and then the saddle actually moved, the auxiliary slide actually moved, and then they were able to give the feed, and then the lathe was rotating. The lathe was rotating in several directions, both clockwise and anti-clockwise, and you have seen how these operations were made. So probably we'll send that video to the coordinating office. Where you can see it better, maybe later. Okay, now we'll continue with this about the different types of lathe. So now the indexing of the turret is the main function which is required. Actually, when you want to bring in various tools to the required cutting position, so how it is by various mechanisms. So one of the mechanisms what you see is called as a ratchet. There are these type of mechanisms are also used in different ways. So first one is the Geneva mechanism, and then to stop it from moving backwards, it is the ratchet mechanism. These combinations we can actually make the indexing of the tools. So here now on the screen what you are seeing is the Geneva mechanism. So where if you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tools, so you can use this type of mechanism. So what is the way how this functions is, so when you make one rotation here, so only one indexing is made. So can you see that one? So the green wheel is rotating for one rotation, but the pin gets engaged and then only one tool has been indexed. So thus the continuous rotary motion is converted into the indexing. So whenever you need, you rotate it by one rotation and then one indexing actually happens. Then the other mechanism which is used is a ratchet and pawl mechanism. Probably in kinematics you would have studied this type of mechanism, where it can rotate in only one direction. So in other direction, even if it wants to rotate, it is not, because the pawl will come and then it will stop the return motion. So thus it can rotate only in forward direction. So that this type of simple mechanisms are used in the capstan and the turret lathe to index it and then to stop it at the required position. So various differences of them. So as I said earlier, so in many of the exams, so these type of questions will be asked. So what is the difference between capstan and turret lathe? So you should be able to explain them. So there are different types of turret lathes also. So the one what you see here is the horizontal turret lathe. So which is the general one what we see, where the axis of the workpiece, the cylindrical workpiece and the machine tool axis is horizontal to the ground. So it is called as the horizontal turret lathe. Then there are vertical turret lathes. So where it looks something like a drilling machine, but this is not a drilling machine. You can see a turret here. So where manually by holding this rod and pressing downward, you can index to the required tool. And then the workpiece is rotated on this table, which is actually horizontal. So even this, if this is an irregular shaped workpiece, you can mount it, and then if you want to drill a hole or turn a cylindrical part, you can do this on the vertical turret lathe. So then nowadays we have even the NC controlled turret lathe. So what is the difference between the completely CNC lathe, so that is called as a CNC turning center, So, and the turret lathe is that. So, this indexing is done automatically, but you have these several tools which are mounted here. But for CNC machines, regular CNC machines, either it may be even milling or turning, so where there will be a provision for ATC, automatic tool changer, to change the tools. But if the number of tools are limited to 6, 4 or 6 like that, then it is better to have actually a turret here on which the tools are mounted, and quickly we can index it to the required tool. Generally in an ATC automated tool changer, there will be an arm which actually holds the tool and then places it on the tool holder or puts it on the tool magazine. But here all those setups are not required. So we can quickly index it to the required tool and then we can carry on the production process. Then we have the tool room lathe. So where it's a high precision lathe, whenever you want to make some of the tools or turn them, so we are going to use this type of tool room lathe. An automatic lathe, so this again the lower kind of a version to the CNC machines, so where indexing and also the turning process feeding will be done automatically. You engage a lever, it moves, then there will be a dog. When it touches that, it moves backward, and again a depth of cut will be automatically given, and then it goes on. So thus is an automatic lathe. Then automatic lathe, there are different types. So there can be a single spindle. So usually what you see in the shop floor will be a single spindle automatic lathes. But in order to increase the production, on the right side you see a lathe machine where there are four spindles. So there can be four spindles on which you can mount four work pieces, and then you can machine them or turn them simultaneously. So thus these type of multiple spindle automatic lathes will give you much higher production when compared to the ordinary lathe machines. The CNC lathe, or what I said as the turning centers, so these component, these machines are specialized computer numerically controlled machines. If you want to machine a complicated profile, so what you are seeing at the bottom side, so you can see that when you have such kind of a complicated components and the shapes, so you can easily machine them by programming the CNC machines. Okay, the other topic what you need to look is the tool holding devices. So we have already seen the work holding devices. So we have said various types of checks, collets, and then magnetic checks and all. So similar to that, for a tool, there are different types of tool holding devices. So maybe if you look at the figures, you'll probably understand it better. So we have also the two-dimensional sketch here. This was available in your textbook. So you can maybe in an exam, if they ask what are the different types of tool holders, you can sketch and explain them. And now to understand it better, you can see the picture on the left side. So the straight cutter holder, this is the ordinary type of tool holding device which you can see on the common lathe. And then on the bottom side, you see the multiple cutter holder. So in case you want to carry out step turning with the different steps, as you can see on the right side in this sketch. So when you want to make a step turning like this, you can have two tools simultaneously engage with the workpiece. And then you can make the operation. Thus the production rate will be high, and we can make the workpiece in the shorter production time. Then there are knurling tool holders. So in the last class, we have said that whenever you want a rough surface for gripping, so we can have the, we can do the knurling operation, and then the knurling tool doesn't look like our single point cutting tool, but they'll be looking like this on the top left side figure. This is knurling tool, and this is called as the knurling tool holder. And also whenever you have slender rods, so where you need the higher support, So we have what is called as the roller box turning attachments. So where you can see these rollers. So on the right side bottom figure, so you can see the rollers which will be supporting the job so that you can remove the material in the tool as you do it in the lathe machine. But then it gives a support so that the rod will not bend, and if it is a slender one, it will not get distorted. This is called as a roller box turn attachment. Then the next one, we have adjustable knee tool. So tool holder, where we, if you want to adjust the height, you can do that. So you can see on the right side, the body is there. We have the bore here where you can clamp it at different positions. Then the next one is a pilot bar and a multiple turning head. So where there is a pilot rod, as you can see in this 2D diagram, the rod will be there. So you can have the multiple tools which are mounted. Then we have the slide tool holder, where is also you can adjust the heights, you can adjust the length, so that without changing the whole setup, you can slide these things and you can make that. So generally, when you are turning deep holes, internal holes, so we call that operation as the boring operation. So where we have a single point cutting tool, so as you can see the bit what is written here is the cutting tool, a single point cutting tool mounted on the boring bar, and then the workpiece rotates. You can enlarge the internal holes. So initially you need to make a hole, maybe by drilling process, and then we can enlarge them by using this process. And then the tool holder is this. Then the combined bar stop and centering tool. So where we have the adjustable center drill, you want to adjust the height so that the tool will be at the center of the axis of the workpiece. You can adjust that and then make a countersink. So rather than calling it as a completely a drilling operation, we call them as a countersink. So where a short hole will be drilled by mounting the drill bit on the tailstock. Is it clear? Any doubts? Okay, the next Danes. So this probably you would have studied maybe in kinematics of machineries. So about different types of gears, then the gear ratios, how to select a gears to obtain the required speed. So all these things probably you would have studied in another subject. But now what we are going to deal is the gears which are related to our particular lathe machine. So as we have already seen, when you have a engine lathe, so where we need to change the speeds, but as I already said, these days we have the continuous machine tools, continuously variable spindles, where the speed can be varied from zero to the maximum range. But in the older lathes, so the speeds can be changed only in steps, so like 150, 200, 250, like that. So in that kind of a case, these gear boxes are being used. Give me a minute. In the gear trains, we have a driver gear and then we'll have a driven gear. In between, there can be idler gates or there can be smaller gates or pinion gates. They can have a different ratio, but the important ones are the driver gear and the driven gear. So different types of gear trains which are used in lathe and also actually in other engines and then other transmissions. So the different types are a simple gear train, a compound gear train, a reverted gear train, and a p-cyclic gear train. So these are main types. So probably if you look at the figures, you can understand them better. So what you see here is a simple gear train. So what is a simple gear train? when there is only one gear on each shaft, it is known as a simple gear train. When the distance between the two shafts is small, the two gears are made to mesh with each other to transmit the motion from one shaft to the other. So these are generally the shafts are parallel to each other. So when the distance between the two shafts starts, two gears are made mesh with some other gear in between them to transmit the motion on the shaft. So these can be the idler gears. So what is a compound gear train, and what is the difference between simple gear train and compound gear train? So when there are more than one gear on a shaft, so that will be called as the compound gear. So you can see here in the middle a gear. So you see both gear B and gear C on the same shaft. So for A and D, so they are single gears, but on this middle shaft, so gear B and also gear C are on the same shaft. So these type of gear trains are called as the compound gear trains. So what is the advantage of compound gear train over a simple gear train is that much larger speed reduction from the first shaft to the last shaft can be obtained with the smaller gears. So thus, with the combination of these gears, you can get higher gear reduction. So we have here, what you are looking at is a reverted gear train. So when the axis of the first gear, that is the drive gear, and the last gear, or the driven gear, are coaxial, then the gear train is known as a reverted gear train. With these kind of complicated gears in between, so we have gear 1, 2, 3 and 4. So now the axis of gear 1 and 4 are inline. So they are inline. It's only parallel, but they are inline. So these type of gears are called as the reverted gear train. That means it looks as if on the shaft, on one side the gear is rotating with one speed, on the other side you find that it is rotating with a different speed. So both the shafts will be in the same line. The axis of the first gear, gear 1, and the fourth gear will be in line. They will be coinciding if you extend. So this type of gears are called as the reverted gears. So in automobile transmissions, so generally these type of gates are used so to transmit the power from engine to the wheels. So these type of gears will be used. And then we have another interesting type of gear called as an epicyclic gear train. So where you have internal gates and also you have the external gear trains. So you can see the picture, so probably you can quickly understand the arrangement of the gear. So you have outside this gear, where gear A is there, and then arm B is there, and then we have a common axis at O1 and O2. So they both have the same axis about which they can rotate, or the arrangement can be as in this gear, where you see one internal gear and then we have four external gears with one in the middle, and then three coaxially. So this type of gates are called as cyclic, epicyclic gear train. Any doubts, question? If you have any questions, you can ask for cam. So cam rod. So we have actually a interesting video which will be able to show you how the camshafts. So camshafts are used in the engines. Probably if you'd have studied thermodynamics or about IC engines, you'd have had a subject where you have a camshaft. So how to machine that? So that is done on a single setup. So we'll show you the video. So the Nodal Center in JNTU Kakinada, I think they'll play you the video. You can see that. After that, so we are going to look at the thread cutting, and then we have a small simple problems to solve whenever you want a required pitch, how to do that. So can the Nodal Center at JNTU Kakinada, can you play that video which I sent in the morning? Thank you. అదే. వాట్ ఈస్ క్యామ్? ఐ థింక్ యూ షుడ్ హవ్ స్టడీడ్. సీ నౌ లైక్ క్యామ్ టైమింగ్ యూ వుడ్ హవ్ సీన్ ఇన్ ది స్వింగ్ మిషన్స్. సో ద మోషన్ ఆఫ్ అప్ అండ్ డౌన్ ఆఫ్ ది needle, even that is also done by using a cam. So you would have probably done a timing diagram for engine valve opening and closing. So there also the cam will be used. So, and also the profile of a cam is important. If the profile of a cam is just circular, and then if there is a roller, nothing happens. But then if it is, think that it is like an elliptical shape. So then now what is going to happen is, you can actually get an up and down motion. You put a roller on that, and then the roller follower will be moving up and down. So thus, by using the cam, you can get the various desired motion. So where you want to open and close these valves, generally in the IC engine, so we need that. So every IC engine, what you are seeing, either it is two wheelers or three wheelers, so this kind of a shaft will be there, and then you have the provision to open and then close the valves, and other timings you can maintain. So thus, this is a very interesting component, and there are several operations which need to be done. And as you know, the production rate of these automobiles, either it is two wheelers or three wheelers, it is very, very high. That means the production rate should be high. So you can't have like several tools changing them every time and then machining them and also inspecting them. So you can't waste that time. So here you have seen all are done in a single setup. And also many times in manufacturing, the single setup plays an important role. So later, probably when you study about CAM metrology, so where you talk about what is called as a datum. When you fix a workpiece on the machine tool, so the bottom surface generally becomes a reference surface or a datum surface, and all the other features, maybe like holes or slots or anything, so they need to be machined with reference to that. Think that if that plane is inclined, the whole of the component actually becomes tilted. For example, you mount a slant workpiece and then try to machine a square block, so you won't get that one. So thus, that surface becomes a reference. Now, if you are going to do the machining of a single component in two setups, so you'll be losing the reference, and then even inspection becomes difficult, and then you will not be able to maintain the required accuracies. So the basic principle in machining is, if you have a component with complicated shapes and when several operations need to be done, if you can do that in one setup, that is the best. So now here you see this crankshaft here. So it is a complicated profile with eccentric thing. So you see the main shaft here, but then you have another cylindrical portion here. So it is an eccentric. And then you have the holes here, and also you see a gear which needs actually milling. Like this, there are several features on that. So how do you manufacture them? By using a single setup. So that is what you have seen. Can somebody, those who saw this video, can you tell how many operations were carried out? You can type in the number, and if you can tell what are those operations, it will be good. So you have seen so many operations being done. So can you tell what are those different types of operations, and how many operations? Can you type in at least how many operations were there? Okay, so here on the slide, what you are now seeing is an interesting actually operation. So you can type in the answers later. In between, I'll be explaining this thing. You see here this hole. So generally the coolant will be circulated inside this shaft, because there'll be heat will be produced, and then you'll be traveling for a long time, so a lot of heat will be generated. To remove that and also to lubricate them, we need the deep holes. So probably when you're traveling on a bike or even in a car, so sometimes you just increase the accelerator. So what is actually happening inside? You have the piston which will have to reciprocate at such a high speed, and then these kind of a camshafts opening, closing and all need to be done at a very high speed. So generally the RPM in the two wheelers or even the automobiles, it will be around 6000 to 10,000 RPM. That means 10,000 times, see, the piston have to reciprocate inside the cylinder in a minute. So it's a very high speed. So when that kind of a thing is happening, and also when you are driving for a long time, so the heat gets generated. So to remove that heat and also to send the coolant oil, we need a deep holes. And these kind of a holes are also required in the engine block. So how do you make that? That is an interesting thing. So you see here a very slender tool, and generally we call what is called as an aspect ratio, where you are going to take the length divided by the diameter. When you take that for these kind of a tools, it will be very high. Like you have 100 millimeters and diameter is 10, it will be 10 ratio. So for these type of a tools, it will be very high. And what will be the difficulty is that the tool can suddenly break. So it will bend, it will deflect, or even it can break finally. But the tools have been made hardened in such a way that they'll be able to make these kind of a deep holes. And nowadays, even in engine blocks, these type of the holes, the diameter will be smaller, but the length required will be very higher. So these type of holes are called as an high aspect ratio holes. So to make them, it's a big challenge. So, but now we have the technologies by means of which you can do that. So this is one of the operation what you have seen. And the coolant was coming out through this one. So that is coaxially. And nowadays there are tools, so where there will be a central hole through the tool itself. When it is a deep hole, the chips need to come out, and also the coolant has to reach the tip. So how do you make it from outside? If you even pour the coolant, it doesn't reach the deep hole inside. So for that, what they have is, they have the drill bits where inside there'll be a hole, and then the coolant will be circulated through that. Actually, we have a micro drill bit where the diameter of the drill bit is around 500 or 400 micrometers. That means 0.4 or 0.5 millimeters. And inside that, there is a central hole to take a probe and then inspect. So all these things, if you do that, if there is any error, you have to bring it back, mount it on the machine again, and then do the machining. You'll be losing all the references or the datum. So that is not good. And also there is a lot of time which will be wasted. So thus, to avoid that, nowadays in the CNC machines, one of the tool is a probe. So like a CMM, coordinate measuring machine probe. So it will come and touch the component which it has machined, and then you can see the readings there. So by means of which you can know whether your dimensions are correct or not. So all these things are actually done on the same setup. So thus the camshaft or the crankshaft is one of the complicated components which are made in thousands in any of these industries. And they need to be done at a very high production rate and in one single setup. So you have seen the video how they made it. So the last topic in this unit, that is about the lathe, that is the second unit in your syllabus, is thread cutting on lathe. I don't know whether you have done this operation in your first year workshop. Turning and then threading, probably you would have done it. Here what we are looking at is, we have a cylindrical rod and then we need to get the thread. So the type of the thread, the profile of the thread, get the required pitch. So the two motions are very important, as you see in the small that inline picture here. So what is important for us is the rotational speed and the linear feed, the feed along the axis. So if you can maintain that, you can get the required pitch. So that need to be maintained. And then that is the longitudinal feed and the rotational speed. So how do we do that? So before that, there are a few terms about the thread, which probably you would have already known it. One is called as a pitch, then the other one is called as the lead. So lead is the axial movement of a screw traveled in its one revolution. Then what is the pitch? Pitch is the distance between one point on the thread to the corresponding point on the other thread. So okay, so if you take a thread, so one from one point to the other one. Now what is the difference between this lead and pitch? Is it same or different? Equal. But in a multiple start threads, the lead will be equal to the number of starts into pitch. What is this number of starts? So if you observe carefully the threaded portion of it, so when you are turning it or rotating a lid in your bottles, so like for example, you have a bottle when you are looking at here. So what I see here for this bottle is a single start. Okay. So for one rotation, it's only moving. So I need to make 2-3 rotations. So, but if you have a double start, with half of that, I can tighten the lid. So thus, single start and double start means, so it will be starting from this particular portion, one thread will be starting. After 180 degrees, the second one will be starting. If it is a three start, then after every 120 degrees, one thread will be starting. So thus, if you want with a small rotation, more linear distance to be traveled, so then you can go for the multiple start thread. So generally double start threads are common, single start and double start threads will be common. Okay, so now what we need to know here is the lead and then the rotational speed. So there is a simple formula here. So for thread cutting, the ratio of gears between the start gear or the driven gear, the driver gear to the lead screw gear, that is driven gear, is formed from the following simple formula. So driver by driven will be equal to lead of the thread on the workpiece what you want divided by lead of the thread on the lead screw which is there in the machine tool or on the lathe. So remember that driver by driven is equal to lead of the thread what you want on the workpiece divided by lead of the thread on the lead screw of the lathe machine. If it is actually only a single start, then you can make it as pitch of the thread on the workpiece divided by pitch of the lead screw which is there on the lathe machine. So generally there'll be a simple problem which will be asked like this, so probably you can quickly solve it and send the answer. So where it says find the charge gears to cut a right hand single start thread of 2 millimeter pitch. So the pitch what I require is 2 millimeter on a lathe having a lead screw of 8 millimeter pitch. Okay, so I need 2 millimeter pitch on my workpiece and then the lead screw of the machine has an 8 mm pitch. So the gears what are available in the gearbox of the lathe are shown on in the diagram in the right side. So you can note down what are the gears which are there. And now you need to give me how do you adjust this gear ratio to achieve 2 mm pitch thread on the workpiece. So if you can calculate and type in the answer, we can look at the other things and then close the class. So can you calculate? need to be used, and it is a single start thread, so it is not complicated at all. N2 is equal to N3. What is N2 and what is N3? So to achieve this pitch on the workpiece of 2 millimeters, so what should be the gear ratio? So what the ratio what you are getting here is 2 by 8 or 1 by 4. So we need to have a gear ratio with 1 by 4. So here, if you look at the diagram here, what are the gears are available are 20 and 80, 60 and 30 are there. So what combination I need to select now is one with a 20 teeth and one with an 80 teeth. So if I select that one, so I'm going to get the ratio what I need. So this is how it is a simple problem. So we should be able to solve. So now to make it more complicated, you can take with a double start. So or you want a single start on your workpiece, but your lead screw is a double start. You can make it that complicated, or you want even a double start thread on the workpiece, and you have either single start or if it is also double start on the lead screw. So what is that ratio? All these kind of problems we can solve it, but I think you can do it by yourself. So now this actually brings to the end of the first unit. So to summarize what you have studied, so the second unit, it talks about the lathe machines, and then it talks about the engine lathe, the working principles, the specifications of the lathe, the types of lathe, work holding devices, tool holding devices, box tool, taper turning, thread turning. So like this it goes on, and then it talks about the gearbox, it talks about the turret and capstan lathe, then different types of checks, work holding devices, then about automatic lathes, single spindle and multi-spindle automatic lathes, tool layout and cam design for automat. So all these things is what we have studied. I don't know if all of you are having the books. So these are the books which actually your university has specified. So Manufacturing Processes by J.P. Kaushik. And P.N. Rao. So Manufacturing Technology by P.N. Rao. So these are the two textbooks which your university has given. You can refer to them. And more details are there in Manufacturing Technology. Other textbooks, you can look them. One of them is Kalpak Jian. So that book is also good, Kalpak Jian. So there are, if you are more interested in cutting tools, so A.B. Chattopadhyay textbook is also there for metal cutting. So you can refer to them for more details, and you can study. I think you remember your semester plan. So you were, we are here in the last week of July. So next week we'll have the classes. So that is on 1st, that is Wednesday, and then 3rd. So after that, you are going to... Small video, you can still see that.